everyone for joining Geoff and I in this informal chat with Dr. Ramesh Mashelkar. I'd like to begin the conversation by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land on which Geoff and I are meeting with Ramesh today. For me in Sydney, the ancestral lands of the Gadigal of the Eora Nation, and we extend our respect to elders past, present, and emerging. Ramesh is joining us from Pune, India. By way of introductions, my name is Erin Roger, and I'm the chair of the Australian Citizen Science Association. I'm joined by Dr. Geoff Garrett, ACSA's patron, who has been instrumental in helping ACSA make valuable connections and partnerships. Geoff has also served as a great sounding board and provided much appreciated advice in terms of best approaches and tactics for the association. And we are so appreciative of the work that Geoff does. I mentioned that Geoff has made valuable connections, and one of those people is to Dr. Ramesh Mashelkar. Ramesh has the most impressive biography, and I encourage you to visit his website, as well as a shortened summary on ACSA's online event website. In short, Ramesh has been honored as a Fellow of the Royal Society, Foreign Fellow of US National Academy of Science and Engineering, Foreign Associate of the American Academy of Arts and Science, and Fellow of the US National Academy of Inventors. Here in Australia, he is a Fellow of both our Academy of Science and our Academy of Technology and Engineering. He has been awarded an honorary doctorate from no less than 42 universities around the world, which is an interesting number if you're a Douglas Adams fan. In addition to all this, one of the many areas that Ramesh writes widely about is the topic of resilience, and he describes himself as a dangerous optimist. So welcome both.
Righto, Erin, thank you very much indeed for that introduction. And for me personally, it's a huge delight to hook up with my old special friend, Ramesh. We go back well over 20 years. We first actually met when I was running CSIRO's sister organization in South Africa called CSIR, where we invited and he came in the brand new South Africa with all sorts of change going on. And Ramesh made an inspirational contribution in terms of helping us chart out our strategy going forward in a very significant changing environment under Mr. Mandela's government. And we've kept in touch over the years and enjoyed it and visited each other on several continents, and our families are good pals too. So it's a great pleasure, an honor, in fact, for me to have the opportunity to pose some questions. I would say at the outset, there's the old saying, an evening across the table with a wise man is worth a month of study in books. We haven't got a whole evening. We've just got this 15 or 20 minutes. But I have no doubt at all that everybody we're watching will pick up some serious pearls of wisdom from Ramesh. So kicking off on that sort of dangerous optimist word, Ramesh, if I may, you know, highlight in your website. And I would encourage, and Erin's put the link in to Ramesh's website there. I would encourage people to browse that. Pick up on some of his many readings and learnings and papers, and we'll come back to that. And there's a slide set in particular that we'll refer to around the 10 tenets of resilience that I would recommend you all to browse, and we'll pick up on that later. So how do you retain your positivity and optimism during a situation which is ravaging the world, as we all know, and particularly, you know, amongst many others, but in India, where you're recording the sort of numbers of new cases each day, and many would say crisis situation writ large. So from a personal perspective to pick up on, tell us about Ramesh and Ramesh's optimism in the face of crisis.
Right. Thank you very much, Geoff. First of all, I want to reciprocate very warmly to your wonderful words. You know, we go a long way, and you and I have, I would say, brotherly relations over a period of time, and it's wonderful to see you, although digitally. Well, as far as your first question is concerned, I would say what keeps me going is my infinite faith in human spirit, so as to say, you know. And to begin with, I must also say I have a way of looking at things, basically. And for that, let me tell you a small story. I remember I was invited by the Physics Teachers Association of Delhi University, and there was a huge turmoil in Delhi University. Everybody was giving up on things and so on and so forth. A lot of dismay, a lot of despair. And the individual who introduced me, he said, ladies and gentlemen, as you know, we are in coma. And now Dr. Mashelkar will tell us what to do. And Geoff, I had just 10 seconds in which to think about what I'm going to talk to 500 people who are in coma. So I said, maybe the gentleman did not mean we are in coma, we are at a coma. And I said, the beauty of a coma is that you have completed part of the sentence, you are taking a pause, looking back, and the rest of the sentence could be a positive one, followed by another one, a paragraph, a page, and it could be a golden chapter. It's up to you to write, complete the rest of the sentence. And Geoff, it had a magical effect, as a matter of fact, because they were going to take a procession to the vice chancellor at the end. They said, no. And anytime there was a certain dispute, they said, what did Professor Mashelkar say, coma or a coma? So I think the current despair is like as though we are in coma and what to do and et cetera. Like I mentioned, 0.1 million new cases per day in India, et cetera. But I think this is a time for us to not just try to recover, but reinvent ourselves, reinvigorate ourselves, reimagine ourselves. And I have always believed that there are no limits to human imagination, no limits to human achievement, no limits to human endurance, except the limits that one puts ourselves. And we have seen that again and again. This is not the first pandemic. There are natural disasters. There are human-made disasters. We have had natural disasters like cyclones and tsunamis and floods, human-made disasters and world wars, for example, pandemics, whether it was SARS, swine flu, and so on and so forth. So we have risen again. That gives me the hope. So short answer to your question is my enormous faith in the human spirit to spring back, to bounce back.
So let's build on that, if we may, Ramesh, and bring it to the personal and the sort of setbacks that you've had in your life and the challenges you've had from a very early age. And you know, I love telling some of your stories, and hopefully you'll tell some of them yourself. And I should say to the audience that I've used them with great joy around some of those early setbacks and how Ramesh recovered from them. But how have you gone about, at a personal level, your words, reinventing, reimagining Ramesh Mashelkar in those circumstances?
Right. Geoff, I believe that you can't change the beginning, but you can change the end. I had very hard beginnings, as you know. You know, I was born in a very poor family. My father died when I was six. My brother, mother brought me to Mumbai. She was illiterate. She did manual work to bring me up. I studied under streetlights. I walked barefoot until I was 12. But, you know, there is what is called as a scarcity and there is what is called as an aspiration. And the combination of scarcity and aspiration is absolutely deadly. And I believe that's what has helped me in my life. In fact, I distill the lessons of my life, which made me resilient, as just what I call as five Mashelkar mantras. And, you know, I talk very widely across the world, particularly to the young people and so on and so forth. And these are the secret five mantras. I think the first is aspirations are your possibilities. Keep them high. The second is there is like instant coffee. There is no instant success. There is no substitute to hard work. Geoff, I work 24/7, day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, and I'll continue to do so till the last day of my life. But my mantra has been that work hard in silence and let success make all the noise. The third one is there is this purpose, perseverance and passion, they have to go together. There's always a big purpose in life, you know, the North Star purpose, which you have to keep in mind. And as far as perseverance is concerned, I always said that it's too early to give up. Winners are never quitters and quitters are never winners. And I've never given up in my life, both in my science as well as in my personal life. The other thing that I have discovered is that you keep on knocking on the doors of opportunities and they don't open. What do? Don't get frustrated. You create your own doors. And I've done it in my own life when I returned from door, because otherwise I would have been just waiting for some equipment to come from abroad for 2 years and so on and so forth. We don't have time to sort of talk about it. And the last point is, you know, I have always believed that my best is yet to come. And I have made a mantra in my life. Every morning that I get up, you know, I say my best is yet to come. And maybe today will be the day when it will come. And I'm doing it at 77. I don't know how many years I've left with, but I can assure you, Geoff, on my even my last day, when I breathe my last, I will say my best is yet to come. I would say these are the five mantras, which are the secret to my positivism and resilience.
That's brilliant, Ramesh. I'm going to hand over to Erin, who's got the next question from you. I'm sure building on that wisdom there.
Yeah, thank you so much, Ramesh. I've been jotting things down. I love that you can't change the beginning, but you can change the end. I'm going to add that into some of my personal mantras. People always say, though, there's this term, water off a duck's back, which implies just, you know, shrug it off, keep moving. But personally, I find that I dwell on situations, and I'm not terribly good at this. I'm interested in hearing more if you've got some ideas or insights about how we as individuals can become more resilient, so adopt some of the mantras that you have. And in your mind, what are some of the defining characteristics of resiliency?
Yeah, excellent question. I would say I have two heroes, by the way, as far as resiliency is concerned. You know, the first, Nelson Mandela, and the second, Mahatma Gandhi. And if you see Nelson Mandela, for example, and he's my real iconic hero. He had a number of quotes vis-a-vis the secret to his resilience, but one of that, and I will quote him, he says, part of being optimistic is keeping one's head pointed toward the sun and one's feet moving forward. Mahatma Gandhi, for example, it was resilience through non-violence and satyagraha, you know, and British finally had to give up. He was so resilient. So I think these are the models, but then you will say, Erin, that everybody can't be Nelson Mandela, everybody can't be Gandhi. We are what we are, huh? Right? You are Erin and I'm Ramesh and Geoff is Geoff and so on. So what do we do? So I think there are some basic sort of principles. I think the first basic principle is a strong sense of purpose is the bedrock from which coping, healing, recovering after adversity becomes possible. That is a fundamental. The other thing is that there are three dimensions to resilience: emotional, spiritual, and mental. Emotional, that means when you're faced with an adversity, calming and focusing, having an impulsive control, emotional regulation, realistic optimism. Although I'm dangerously optimistic, I'm opting for realistic optimism. Spiritual, the values and belief therein, which are very, very important. I don't think we should worry about sympathy. We should be talking about empathy. We should be talking about compassion in the heart, reaching out. And the last one is mental, which is kind of self-belief. Yes, I can do spirit. And there, you know, any conversation with Geoff, we have to talk about cricket. So I will bring in cricket here, Geoff. And I'll tell you a little story and from which I will draw about mental makeup. You know, as you know, Sunil Gavaskar was a great cricketer who sort of retired and had all sorts of centuries, including breaking Broadman's record. And once I was talking to him, how did he sort of do that? You know, and he told me a secret. He said, you know, he played his first matches in West Indies, as you know, where bowlers were twice his height, as a matter of fact, would come from a distance and bowl him and he wouldn't be able to even see the ball, right? And he said, when I was defeated, when I took the stand for the next ball, I had this uncanny ability to wipe off that ball from my, as though this was the first ball that I was being bowled. So what does it mean? Is that rumination, actually, you know, kills the mind because you keep on saying, oh, this would have done, I would have done that, et cetera, et cetera. So just cut it off. And the other mantra he gave me was that the meaning of fail. Fail means first attempt in learning. That is how fail has to be interpreted. So he said, your best teacher, your best guru is your last mistake. Okay? You learn from it and you don't sort of repeat it. So I would say these three dimensions, emotional, spiritual, and mental, I think if we develop, we become resilient.
Thanks for that.
That's great.
Geoff, Geoff, you've lost your camera.
Oh, okay. Let me, oh yes. Okay, now I'm there. Good. Ramesh, let me then come from that lovely stuff at the personal level. We'll come back to that before we conclude for sure. At the sort of more macro level, we've talked about the challenges that you know, the world has undertaken over the last, particularly the last 8 months, the societal gains over the previous decade, lots been lost in terms of jobs, health, the environment, and lots of other things, and inequality escalating. How do you sense if you were advising your prime minister, when you're advising your prime minister, how we can go politically, I guess, and commercially and from a society's point of view, future-proof both ourselves and the society and learn from the experience? And maybe specifically you can pick up on some of your, you know, your top favorite two or three tenets of resilience that might play to that that tune there around, or my question. What are your thoughts around at that macro level, shall we say, to start with?
Yes, I think the lives have been lost, livelihoods have been lost. The damage is absolutely enormous. I mean, 400 million jobs lost just in quarter two of 2020. Or 100 million people have been pushed from poverty to extreme poverty, you know. And as you know, 1.6 billion children have been actually moved out of school, and 32, and it is online learning now, but they can't, 30 to 40% of them can't do online learning because they don't have either the devices or the connectivity. This is true across the world. So we are facing sort of a huge problems. What do we do about it? I think the first is that a lot of fault lines have been exposed in the pandemic, and we need to learn from that. For example, our public health systems, you know, all across the world, as a matter of fact. So we need to fix them. Inequalities have increased enormously, basically. What is the solution to that? You know, it's interesting. It was in a hotel in Sydney when I jotted down my first thoughts on Gandhian engineering, getting more from less for more. And you remember, Geoff, that in Canberra, when I was given the fellowship of our technology and engineering academy, my talk was Gandhian engineering, getting more from less for more and more people, not just for more and more profit. So I, as a matter of fact, because we have reduced resources from which we have to get sort of more. And most importantly, I would say, from this pandemic, what I will like to learn is that this is a trailer of what will happen if a full-fledged climate crisis would entail. Huge disruptions on demand side, as we have seen. Huge disruptions on supply side, as we have seen. Huge speed of global transmission, as we have seen, and global amplification. It's a trailer, Geoff. And therefore, I think we can't be reticent anymore. And we have to double up our effort on being not just good, but also being green. And the last point I would emphasize, and you and I have vested interest in that in terms of science, but pandemic is a humbling, but also an acute reminder that science is our only defense, from not only the current pandemic, but for future. And therefore, actionable science, when one of the heads of state said yesterday that science does not know. No, that will not work. As a matter of fact, we have to redouble our faith in science. I would say at a macro level, these will be my
That's great. Thank you for that.